I'm not ashamed to say I have role models. And a lot of these younger guys are ashamed to say that they look up to a certain person. And I'm not ashamed to say who I look up to, and a lot of these guys are. And
who do you look up to?
I look up to Cal Ripken. I look up to Nolan Ryan. I look up to Wayne Gretzky. I look up to Jim Thorpe. I look up to all those guys, Walter Payton. Those guys right there, Dr. J. Because they is what the game is all about. That's what
which
it's
about.
Which is having fun and never leaving anything away from your playing field or your playing surface. Put it all out there and see what happens. And I'm not ashamed to say I admire those guys, and I admire some of the young guys. Just go out and play the game of basketball, but some of them I don't.
Dennis Rodman said that there was a time last year when you asked the bus driver to stop the bus because he was reading a Playboy on the bus and you wanted it removed. Is that true?
I think Dennis was exaggerating a little bit there. I don't remember ever stopping the bus. I think guys, they understand where I stand.
But would that offend, I mean, something like that would offend you to that point, and you would, I mean, I think that shows your leadership
quality. Yeah, I don't necessarily approve of that, but then it's not something that, I mean, if they're sitting in their seat reading a Playboy, you know, that's really none of my business. But if they start passing it around the bus, you know, we have media people on the bus, we have ladies on the bus or whatever, then that's when I'll step in, I'll say, hey, you either keep that in your bag or wait till you get back to the hotel and you read that, because you know, this is not appropriate for us in this situation.
And so that's just something where you step forward, and do you meet any resistance?
I think they understand that. Yeah, they're respectful because they know me, and they know that I'm not, you know, I'm not going to try to change them as a person. I'm not going to say, hey, look, you got to live a certain way because I'm a certain way.
People take a stand depending upon what they believe in. Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf of the Denver Nuggets recently did that, saying it was his religious belief that he did not want to stand up during the national anthem. Things have since been resolved. When you saw that, what was your reaction?
Geez, when I saw that, I really had to, it was kind of ironic for me, because what I've been talking about, what we've been talking about prior to this, he made that based on a poor understanding of history. If he understood more about the history of the U.S. and what African Americans have given to the U.S., he would know certainly that this is his country, and the Justice Department will investigate anyone's denying him the right to practice Islam. The federal government would do that. They don't care what your religion is. And based on that, according to Islamic law, we owe this country allegiance because they protect our rights as Muslims. There's no question on that. I think it's just something he didn't understand.
How about the story when you were in fifth grade and you got called up to the blackboard? The teacher says, you know, write what you want to be when you
grow up. Yeah, write what you want to be when you grow up, you know. And I wrote, I want to be a pro basketball player. And she grabbed the eraser and erased it from the board and told me to be realistic. So she said, write something else up on the board. And I wrote it again. I want to be a pro basketball player. And she erased it again and told me she'd send me home from school if I didn't write something else up on the board. And when I tell kids this story, I always tell them I have a father who's a police officer and a big man, carries a big gun. And I was thinking about all that walking up to the board. But I wrote, I want to be a pro basketball player once again.
How about in college? You play for Jim Boeheim at Syracuse, a guy who has been criticized often. Where is he on a scale of 1 to 10?
Well, you're putting me on the spot because I think...
Well, that's my job. That's what I do. I ask questions. But however you want to answer I think people wonder. You played for the guy you know.
You know, the problem with Boeheim is that he just... if you look at his Syracuse players, the problem that I have with him is he's never prepared us for the NBA or for the afterlife because he never stressed discipline. And when you're coming to his hands at the age of 17 or 18... He should be a father figure. He should be a guy that tells you, you know, this is the way it should be done. Discipline, discipline, discipline. This is why most of the Syracuse players have no discipline, because they could do whatever they want, and they just, you know, they have a loose leash. And thank God he has Bernie Fine there, because he holds it back a little bit, Bernie. And
you think that's hurt Derek Coleman and his pro career?
No doubt about it, because Derek got away with murder. Not murder, but he got away basically with anything he wanted. He's a great player. I love Derek. I think he's misunderstood by a lot of people. He wants to win, but you know, same thing that happened to Pearl and to other players that have played the Syracuse as well.
Would you say you're an angry player?
No.
Or you play angry?
I'm just an intense player, you know, and I think a lot of a great deal of people, you know, they have misconceptions
right,
of
they've
me.
They've labeled you an angry
Yeah,
player.
Exactly. They have a lot of misconceptions of me, and that's unfair to me because that's my job. That's what I do. That's my work.
Right.
You know, so why form a conclusion on a person that you've seen on television? Just form a perception of them that, I mean, I'm a mean person. I'm unapproachable. You know, but if you get to know me, you know, the people that know me off the court, they understand me a whole lot differently, and they know how I am. There's a difference between Alonzo, the basketball player. This is my job. This is what I do. And Alonzo, the person, you know, and I never let the two come together.
With these problems that we documented, the Knicks, San Antonio, even in Portland now, is it fair, is it unfair that you're labeled a malcontent or a cancer?
Well, see, I wouldn't say problems. I mean, especially here in Portland, you know, I think I've had a real nice career there for these 3 years, and I think, you know, the fans and the coaches have appreciated me. You know, Rick Adelman was, I think he would tell you that, you know, I worked hard in practice, I came and I gave 100%, and I think, you know, PJ would have to tell you that I work hard and I give 100%, but, you know, it was just a personality clash.
Where do you draw the line between your emotion where you cross the line and you're really offending somebody or making fun of them?
You draw the line when it's real and when it's fake. When it's real or when you're trying to be on TV.
Have you ever gone too far without
When I was with Luke Longley, I went too far.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, even though I don't think they had the situation under control, the referees, at that time, you know, if I had to do it all over again, of course I wouldn't do it. And plus, you know, plus it didn't look too good, so my friends was calling me, telling me I got beat up anyway.
So you still lost.
Yeah, so I lost in both areas.
All right, so now what about when you're in that situation in the past, and somebody does it to you and they cross the line, does that make you angry? Do you say something to them? Do you play harder?
See, that's one thing. That's when you take it personal. See, if a guy talks to me, I might be in a game where I'm just terrible, don't feel good, had a bad day, and the guy talked to me like check up. Oh, I'm ready to play now, you know? So really, it's like a thing to get you pumped up. And that's why, at first at Michigan, oh, yeah, I would talk to the other players. Now, I do most of the talking to Juwan, maybe so that other players can hear it, but to keep us going.
In my situation, I think it's really getting what you think you deserve. Now, if you told me that I was going to die next week or next month, then I would want to really be in the Hall of Fame right now.
It's that important, I mean.
Well, it's because it's something you worked very hard. You know, when I was playing in 63 and 73 and 78 and 79, I didn't think I was going to be a Hall of Famer. Then all of a sudden, a lot of positive things start happening. You're associated with a lot of great players. Of course, you're watching 41-92, and that was a great night for me as an individual. It was a great night for the city of Cincinnati and the fans of Cincinnati. But, you know, and once you play 24 years and you establish as many records as I have, it's more or less getting your due. And I think if the time comes, Chris, and I ever go to the Hall of Fame, and I think I will, I mean, I have to be confident because I was confident as a player, not arrogant, but confident, that I think I will probably appreciate more than any players ever went in there.
Over your years in baseball, which of your accomplishments are you most proudest of? What was the high point? What was the low point?
High point is a championship in Toronto.
World Series, the big hit.
Closest thing to a perfect year you can get. Going in, you know you feel you're the best, and when the season's over, you are the best.
Better than any individual award.
Oh, yeah. They don't come close. I mean, I've gotten a lot of hits, a lot of home runs, a lot of relationships with people. Every place I've played has been great. Hey, the people like me in each city. I've always made contribution to the community. That was just part of me. But the every young kid growing up, when they finish playing on the playgrounds, up against the steps, off the back wall, you know, they finish up the last thing in practice, they say, I'm up, men on base, World Series. Here's the pitch. Bam, you get a hit. You stand out, your chest is a little bigger, and the smile on your face. That's what it was.
And that
grown man, 20 years after I started playing, I fulfilled that dream.
The one shot. And the low point. What was the lowest point in the game?
Oh, in the game, I think that's a good question. There was a time when late 80s, when it seemed everybody, and this happens in people's career, everybody was attacking me, vilifying me. Here I'm hurt in my back. I had disc surgery. They were talking about you're not going to play. They were trying to prevent me from continuing to play. People from the outside were attacking and coming with all kinds of outrageous statements and everything. And so you spend 20 years, build a reputation, and people are trying to destroy it in 20 seconds.
In 1993, your father, Charles, passed away, and he was particularly upset, Tony, with the fact that people labeled you a selfish player when you talk about contact hitters and pointed to your batting race in 1991. Can you recall that story for us?
Yeah, he was, it's kind of a label that goes with a contact hitter, and my dad was upset because in September I was having knee problems, and you know, I'd gone through that selfish thing before, and I just wanted to finish out the year. You know, I didn't care about a batting title or anything. I just wanted to finish out the year and be able to go home. And you know, at the time, my dad told me, "You ought to just sit out. You know, your knee's killing you. Go ahead and get your surgery, so you'd be better for next year." And I told him, "No, I don't want to do it." And he said, "Man, you're leading the league, man. You can win it. Ain't nobody gonna remember." And so I went on, I played, and I finished at 317. That was your Pendleton won at 319. Hal Morris finished at 318. And for years, until he died, I mean, he was on my case about winning his fifth batting title. And so, and that's why last year's was so important to me. You know, I wanted to win one, get it out of the way, and then kind of enjoy baseball again. And in my case, after he passed, it really taught me how important just going out there and having fun is, you know. I mean, after getting that batting title out of the way last year, I've had the most fun I've had in my career.
At the age of 21, you won the World Series, you mentioned, beating the Cardinals. You were voted the MVP. Take us inside your head, pitching that seventh game at that young age, the kinds of things that you were going through, physical things going on, nervousness.
Well, like I said, I had won 20 games that year, and I was nervous all the way up and before
but
the game.
Is that sweaty palms? Is that
sweaty
shaking?
Sweaty palms, or? And just realizing that the whole season is this it. This, the whole season is riding on tonight's game. We either are world champions or we're not world champions. And at that time, I felt like that was a lot of pressure. But once I got out there, started pitching, all that pressure kind of went away, and I just went about my game and scoring a bunch of runs early. I think the final score was 11-0. So we scored a bunch of runs early, and George Brett, Frank White, all these guys are coming back to the dugout in the sixth, seventh inning saying, "Hey, let's go. Let's make some outs so we can celebrate." Right. So
that way
it took a lot of pressure off scoring a lot of runs, and then once the game started.
How come you don't show more emotion when you're out there pitching?
Well, I do. I might not show it. Maybe I just hide it good.
That's by design.
Well, you know, I think, you know, I don't want to act surprised if I get somebody out. That's one thing. And, you know, I'll get upset when I hang a pitch or, you know, the guy has a good at bat off me. I'll get upset at those times. But, you know, I really expect to get guys out. And when I do, I don't want to act surprised.
Very businesslike. And one of the things that makes you successful, you don't panic when things don't go right, when sometimes you have to deviate from your plan or your plan isn't working. How do you maintain that composure?
Well, I think you have to understand that there's going to be peaks and valleys in this game, and especially over the course of a season. You throw over 250 innings, you're not going to throw a shutout every time you go out there, and you're going to get hit. You're going to give up runs. You just try to limit it as best you can, and you know, when you give up three or four in a game, don't give up four or five, and I just try to take that attitude.
Hideo Nomo, the great strikeout pitcher from Japan, first game he was pitching, tell the story when you went out to the mound, and I guess he was having trouble throwing strikes and base runners were on, and you were trying to communicate to him, and what did you say?
Well, I'm kind of embarrassed by it, but we have an interpreter, Mike, you know, I can't quite remember his last name, but he told me a lot of the Japanese, the bad words. So that's a tradition in baseball. I wanted to learn the bad words first.
So you were aware that they
were.
Yeah,
so I went out and I said a couple of the bad words to him, and he started to Nomo, and he started laughing. I mean, he really gets a kick out of it. He's got a great personality, and I think he's learning English very quickly, and once he learns English, I think he's going to be a great, you know, a magnetic type of guy. He's really a lot of fun.
But did you go out there and really not know what else to say? I mean, how to get him to throw strikes?
No, I don't. You know what's funny? I started going out there and talking real. I knew one word, which is ides, which means good. You know, and I go ides, ides, and he's like hi, hi, which obviously means yes. And I said, you know, slow. You know, I like try to tell him to slow down. So I go slow down. He's like. Hi, hi. So, I don't know. I could be saying anything to him.
And he would be nodding.
Yeah, he could be nodding.
I think milk is a great thirst quencher. People don't, they underrate it. I think if it's ice cold, especially non-fat because it goes down a little smoother. You can, I mean, to me, you come off the field and go with milk, and that's not a plug for milk. I mean, they don't need it. But I just tell you the truth. I mean, I think milk gets a bad rap for being kind of sticking to your tongue, you know. I kind of like it.
Well, what about when your teammates, the linemen, the big go out and have a beer or pizza, you sitting there with a pitcher of milk?
Well, you know, it's mostly a joke nowadays. The guys are like, well, you know, give the Mormon kid a milk, you know, and we'll chug contests and that kind of thing. But that's more of a gimmick. You know, I've matured into soda now.
Emmitt Smith, Barry Sanders, you've handed off to both over your career. Pretty fortunate. If you were in that Super Bowl, Rodney, and you needed one of those guys, which one would you take to win the game?
I have been fortunate. I don't think there's anybody
else. You'll sidestep this one now.
I don't think there's anybody else that's handed off to both those guys.
Right, you're right. You're the only quarterback who's had that benefit.
So, I mean, it's...
So you won't upset anybody. They understand this debate.
I would take out the fullback and put them both in the backfield.
I knew you were squirming in the commercial trying to come up with an answer there. We know about their styles. Really, they're that close? You really wouldn't
take one
over the
other? Yeah,
they are,
and they're both different. You know, they're both different. I think that... Emmitt is more of a straight-ahead runner. He's going to get those tough yards for you, and also he's going to make some big runs for you.
Okay.
You know, Barry's more of a slasher, and you know the difference.
I know
but,
all that.
You know, but they're both very very talented, and I think they're both the two top running backs in the game.
And when we're playing at Oklahoma, you said you needed to hurt people. Some of the things that we recall, you needed it like water, and that without football, you might as well be a corpse. I mean, these were some of the things that you talked about. So that anger that you had built up, and also this passion for the game. You said it was difficult. How did you get through it?
Well, that was the only way that I could find a way to excel in my life. That's the one thing that in my life I knew that I was good at. And I liked myself back then for that. You know, I could take the anger that I had inside me, and wherever it came from, I knew how to channel that anger on the football field.
Where do you think it came from? Did you ever wonder about that?
It comes from anything. It comes from frustration at school. It comes from frustration from my relationships with my girlfriend. It comes from frustrations at home with my family.
But you could channel it to the football field only.
Anytime that you can, you know, co-cock somebody in the football field, whether they're watching you or not, that makes you feel good. At least it made me feel good. You know, to watch something, you know, come out of an orifice makes you feel good.
Let me ask you about what it takes to be a middle linebacker in the NFL. Give us the mindset.
I'd say the mindset is of a player who plays every down, has to play through injury, understands a defense, is a quarterback of a defense, and man, just goes all out on every down. Makes every hit, makes hard hits, intimidates his opponent.
Yeah, do you have to be mean?
You have to be mean. There's a certain extent to which you have to be a mean, tenacious type of football player.
Describe mean.
You know, going out, hitting guys, you know, giving it all you got when you make contact with somebody.
So you're not just tackling.
Not just tackling, but, you know, being a tough-willed guy, you know, being a guy in the huddle. When guys look up and they're tired in the fourth quarter, game is on the line, you look to somebody in the huddle that's, man, this guy, he's still going hard, he's still concentrating. That's what I mean by toughness.
You've talked before about your fear, and we all have a fear of dying, but for you, fear of death was greater at one point in your life.
I think at one point in my life, I was just really afraid of death. I mean, I think I thought about it constantly.
So yeah,
I don't want to die. You know, I'm afraid to die. You know, I don't want to be put in the ground. You know, I don't want worms to, you know. I mean, I think all of us have things that we're afraid of. That was one thing I think that I was really obsessed with at one point. Now, you know, death is a part of life, so it doesn't really bother me.
Yeah, I was going to say, how did you get over it? How did you deal with it?
You know, basically, I just became, you know, closer to God, and, you know, I deal with it. Now, I mean, I know that when I die, I mean, I'm obviously my Lord and my Savior, so that's how I deal with it.
So spiritualism, because then death, not necessarily the end.
It's not the end. I, you know, one time I just felt like that was it. You're in the ground, and I don't know how long you stay in the ground. Do you stay there when they come to get you, or whatever, right. But, you know, I feel different about it now.
How do you control your mood on the football field versus when you're off it?
On the field, you know, it's kind of the same way on the field, too.
So you can have a mood outburst on the field.
On the field, too, at any time. You know, I can go through an entire game for, like, three quarters and don't really say too much to the players. You know, let Jim Kelly call the plays, let the coaches do their job. And fourth quarter, it'll just hit me and just, hey, wait a minute, I need to start touching the ball. You know, I start talking to Jim, start talking to the coaches and get real angry if we're not moving the ball with the plays that are the plays that we're using. You know, I get real angry at the coaches and some of the players that, hey, we need to change something, we need to make something different.
Physically, have you ever hit your wife in your 14 years of marriage?
Oh, no, definitely not. And she'll attest to that. And again, this incident that day scared the heck out of me. I'm not a guy that's used to losing control. If people that know me, people that have seen me under stressful conditions, see how I react. And for me to get the way I was that day really scared me and made me go right away and find out why is this happening.
You have gone to counseling, a therapist. What have you learned from that so far?
Just learned a lot about myself, first of all, some of the things that drive me, why I'm so driven to be successful, why I'm so driven to help other people and just overextend myself.
Do you need to slow down?
I really do, and that's one of the things that this is teaching me is how to prioritize and think about the things that are most important in your life and don't take for granted your family, the people who are you think are just going to be there through everything. They need you a little bit more than you think they do.
You've dealt with racism at different levels growing up as a player, as an athlete, and still something, a war that you continue to fight. Take us back, if you can, and this to me was a scary example. It was 1991 when you suffered an injury, played probably about five games, probably your most frustrating year, and letters you received from people that were very, very insulting.
They were insulting to me, they were insulting to my family, and they were insulting to not only my race, but to whites as well as every other
race.
What
do they say? What do you tell us?
Just different slangs like blacks are gorillas and go back to Africa, you're the reason why diseases are being spread around and things of that nature. And, you know, I don't know what their motive was. I think the fact that I was making X amount of dollars, a lot of money, and they saw a player who they might have perceived to have been dogging, or flat dogging, whatever term they put on it, they just felt it's not right, which they have no control over. If a person's injured or a person's hurt, you're supposed to respect that.
But was that the worst example you've seen of, I guess we call it ignorance as much as racism?
It's ignorance. It's totally ignorance. And the sad part about it is racism is not inherited. It's taught. So they had to have gotten it from their parents and so forth and so on. And that's the sad part about it.
You know what had happened? I had heard word from some particular source that Marvin Hagler wanted to fight me again.
Yes.
And I had entertained the thought, particularly with Marvin Hagler. But since then, I have not heard anything. I believe he's still in Milan, Italy.
But what about you? Would you want to fight again? Could you fight again?
I could fight Marvin Hagler. I think that would be something that would be viable. But anyone else, I don't foresee anyone else.
So only Marvin you would come out of retirement to fight?
Only Marvin. I truly believe that would be an easy motivation.
He still thinks he beat you that last time, you know.
That's why we should fight again.
You mentioned George Foreman in the last minute, Ferdy, a guy who has, on this program, spoken in favor of headgear. Should he still, you're talking about safety, should he still be fighting?
He may be the only one that needs headgear. I mean, he gets beaten sideways every time he fights. His head comes out sideways, even the last guy beat him. I don't think George, I mean, listen, George was a great champion. Make no mistake about it. Had Ali not beaten him in Africa, George would have been legendary. He did, and he left to serve God, and that was a very useful and wonderful thing he did. He came back that was not useful. That was not wonderful. He came back with a good excuse. He was going to go rebuild a church. Well, he didn't rebuild a church. And as far as I know, he's got enough money to rebuild a cathedral, a theme park, a parking lot,
so forth.
I believe that George has hit on a perfect character. The outside George, big, fat, rotund, happy-go-lucky, Falstaffian, I love him. He's so great. Is a wonderful guy, but inside there is still the same old rotten George from Africa. Still the same old greedy guy says, give me some more money, I want some more. Now, you know, whether George ever talks to me again or not doesn't make any difference to me because he never talked to me before. So afterwards doesn't make any difference. I think he should get off and stay off.
Let me talk about a couple of the other appearances on the Letterman. It was amazing how you bridged the gap, being an old-time football player connecting with a young audience.
Yeah, well, I don't know.
What's your secret?
I don't know. Everything I said, they laughed. So I kept saying things, they kept laughing.
Does your wife laugh?
No, I was watching TV the other night with her in one of these promo. What do you call it?
Promos. It's a promo, right?
Promos came on, and I said to her, hey, Donnie, I'm really getting to be a star. She says, you're a big jerk. And, you know, she's right.
And how long have you been married?
40 years. Too long.
Where did I go wrong? Right?
I don't know. Now she wants to go 40th anniversary. She wants me to go to Australia. What the hell am I want to go to Australia for? To see kangaroos?
Right.
I go to the zoo and see kangaroos.
No, but don't you want to broaden your horizons, see the world?
I've had enough horizons. I've done everything you possibly could do.
Everything, you've done everything you could possibly do. What's the one thing Art Donovan hasn't done that he needs to do before it's all said and done? I got you thinking now.
The hell with it. What I want to do. Guy said, well, how would you want to die? I said, I got the tree all picked out on the grounds of the Valley Country Club. I'm going to sit under a tree, and I'm going to eat about 15 or 20 kosher hot dogs, eat a couple of pizza pies, drink a couple of cases of beer, and flat out blow up. That's the way I want to go.
at the country club. People use your name in an expression when great players don't get into that ring. You know, they say, hey, do you want to become another Ernie Banks? Have you heard that? Are you bothered by that?
I've heard it a lot. I mean, Dale Earnhardt, I've heard it with...
Dale Earnhardt, huh?
Mattingly, I've heard it with Gail Sayers, Walter Payton, because Walter got into the Super Bowl.
Well, it's nice to hear your name anyway, right? Right. At least people remember. What do you think?
It's really nice, you know. I mean, like, with Cal, to mention my name as a shortstop, it's wonderful. And that's the real beauty of sports to me, Chris, is that those of us who's gone ahead of the generation today, I mean, they bring us back by either breaking our records or bring us back to talk about what we did and did not do. And it's a good feeling to be remembered.
But how about the association with not winning the big one, though? Doesn't that, or not getting the chance, really, in the postseason? Does that haunt you still that you didn't get? Do you feel cheated?
Yes, it does. I feel cheated. I feel it has haunted me for year to date, right now. I mean, thinking about playing in the World Series. I used to dream about it all
really?
The time. And my dreams are always about what Reggie did in 1977 at New York. He had three home runs in the final game. Unfortunately, against the Dodgers, they won and all that. That was my thinking that, boy, I'd like to have done that. But it does haunt me. I think about that a lot.
Excuse us, Ernie Banks. Tell us about Harry Carey and sitting at Wrigley Field, why that is so special.
Well, it's a great place. Harry Carey behaves like a fan. You know, that's why he's such a good broadcaster, because he goes, oh, God, he should have had it, choker. You know, he just announces like a fan should, and people go, you know, can speak in harmony with that.
Baseball needs a commissioner. Who'd be a good one?
I don't know. My friend Mike Vec at St. Paul Saints said the reason they cremated his father, Bill Vec, was so that he wouldn't be flipping over in his grave when he heard Bud Selig was the commissioner.
Wow.
I like that one.
That deserves a wow.
Yeah.
And
who should be the commissioner?
Yeah,
I don't know.
We got about 30 seconds.
Probably not Peter Gammons, though.
Why not?
He should go into public service.
You think if he ran for office, you would vote for him? He looks a little like Andrew Jackson. You feel healthier now that you're not drinking alcohol?
Well, I don't. Anybody, Chris, let me tell you something. If anybody tells you that you can have just as much fun not drinking as you can when you're drinking, is lying. You go to a party, you drink these non-alcoholic drinks or drink water, you can't have quite as much fun as you can the other way. But when you realize, if a guy knows, a doctor tells him, don't drink, then you, if you go ahead and drink, you're stupid. And I'm not going to be stupid. I figured it out long ago. I'd rather be miserable and alive than very happy and dead.
First of all, you know, Zen is the process of becoming awake and mindful. And if there's anything you have to be awake at, it's basketball. And if there's anything you have to be mindful about, it's doing this deed that we do out there in the basketball court. And as intense as that activity is, it's still hard to be awake when you're on the court. You see a few players that are there all the time. Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen are some of the players that are awake all the time. They're in a ready position. They're prepared to play. They know what's happening on the full court scale. They know the clock. They know all the senses that are going on around them. That's the process that we talk about as a Zen process.
How have you been able to keep the game from passing you by?
I think the fact that I enjoy the game. I love the thrill of competition, of competing, of being out there. My mind is right out there with the players because when we have a timeout and they come to the huddle, I can tell them what we're not doing or what we can do to win, or I try and help them to have some kind of success. And players then trust you if they see or really believe that you do have their interest in heart. And you have to, because we can't win without them.
Right.
And you know, I can talk their language. I understand what they're saying. I try and stay in touch with what's going on around me and not be secluded from it.
How has recruiting changed for you?
A lot, because you don't get to evaluate them like you used to. You can't get around them and see what they're really like character-wise, academically, whether they really would take the work ethic we have and all the things it takes to be a player now. See, I'd like to see us go back where the freshmen had a schedule, where the freshmen are happy because they're playing. Freshmen all want to transfer, I guarantee you. Most freshmen, unless they're like Marbury was, where they're starting as a freshman, that sort of thing, or like Glenn was when he was in his first year, that I think that most freshmen are unhappy because they don't understand the work ethic and the level of competition.
34 seconds away, Super Bowl 23. You're 34 seconds away from beating the 49ers and winning it all as a head coach with the Cincinnati Bengals, and then Joe Montana does it to you. When you think back, is that your toughest moment in football ever?
Well, it was so close to reaching the height, you know, being the best in your business and being the best at what you do, among the best players in the world. I mean, the NFL has the best football in the world. And Joe Montana that day was too good for us. I just am happy that the game was decided on a good play rather than on a mistake. Even though we had a chance there, almost to intercept one just prior to the game. The game ended because Joe threw a perfect strike to John Taylor. A good coverage, but a better play offensively, and that's the way, if you got to lose, lose that way.
In 1987, it was rather serious, near-fatal boating accident. Can you describe what you went through at that time?
Well, we're in the middle of a real hot striped bass bite off of the San Francisco, just south of San Francisco, and we got too close into the surf. And we're in a 26-foot boat, a couple of buddies and myself, and we all were fighting fish and didn't pay attention to what was going on when a wave hit us and flipped the boat and catapulted us all off into the surf. And then so it was a little bit of a hair-raising experience and having to swim to shore, but my experience as a surfer when I was a young guy in San Francisco kind of helped out.
But it was, did you fear for your life?
There were moments. I think when we first came up and to look around and make sure that all three of us, in fact, because interestingly enough, about a week before that, a boat had gone over in the same area where there's four people killed. So it was in that type of situation with the undertows and the currents and so forth, it's dangerous.
Does your life flash before your eyes?
Only during football games, when I'm on the sideline, if things aren't going too well.
If you don't have that kind of power, if you don't have the hammer, as one coach told us on the show with the player, if his contract is bigger or gives him more control, then you really, you can't run things like a coach should.
I fell in Detroit. I had very little power. I thought Isaiah had more power. Jack McCloskey had more power. And yet we were able to get it done. I think you have to give more of yourself. I think you have to find ways to sell your ideas and products, maybe through somebody else. I utilized my assistants a lot. And I didn't care that people said, well, he could do this and he couldn't do that. That didn't bother me. My job, they hand you 12 players. They say, get it done. That's your job as a coach. It's that simple.
Do you relax admission standards? Do you feel that you're doing that for basketball players?
I don't think we relax them. I think our admissions director, Arlene Cash, and I work together well.
Do you make exceptions, though, Chad?
Oh, sure we do. But she says, do you think this young man has an opportunity to graduate from the University of Massachusetts? I've been on the money. When I tell her yes, we've had our guys graduate. You will think that we've taken 10 Prop 48s. In my 7 years as head basketball coach, this is going on my 8th year, we've taken 3. Kennard Robinson graduated within 4 years. We had a professor write me a letter saying that he'll never agree with Prop 48 now that he's taught Kennard Robinson, because it's not fair labeling him. We have 2 others in the program now that will graduate on time. Our admissions director looks at me and says, Coach, you're on the money, so we will give you a little leeway. If I wasn't graduating those kids, I wouldn't have the opportunity.
Mike, are you offended at all that you have to sometimes defend yourself or that you come under this criticism after you have been able to have the success that you've had in previous stops? It must bother you a little bit.
I'm disturbed by it, but I'm not offended by it because the media have created an image which is deserving to a degree from particularly my earlier years when I was, I would say, abrasive at times and so on. I think I've grown as a coach and as a person, but that never leaves you. That's right. I mean, they still bring up things that I did 10 years ago in the league, and I'm going to have to live with them. And I know who I am and what I'm trying to accomplish here and what I can bring to this
group. What's the greatest change in Mike Keenan's personality?
Well, I just think the maturation of an individual in this particular case is growth in a lot of different ways. I've gone through, as you know, and we've discussed a lot of personal hardships that have helped me grow, be more patient, be more understanding, and
a calmer, more relaxed guy.
Well, I have an inner confidence that is deeper than it ever has been, and for that reason, it's not going to rock me a great deal right now because I still am very confident in the group we have. I'm very confident where we're going, and I see a bright future for us. And we've got to work through tough times right now, and I'm willing to accept that.
If I see the ball out there, I assume it's coming to me. All right. That's how I look at it.
All right.
I wouldn't take it from anybody else, though.
But is it important for you, though, to shed the image, though, that people take that as Ricky Waters being a selfish player?
Well, really, I feel that way, definitely. But the way I look at it, the guys on my team don't feel that way because they voted me offensive MVP. If they didn't like me, if they didn't like the way I went about my business, they didn't have to vote for me. There were other guys on the team that did a great job on our offense, but they voted for me because they respect what I'm doing. They respect the way I play, the way I practice. No one works harder than me at practice. No one works harder than me on the offseason. I love the game of football. I love to play it. They see that, and they see that that is what I'm all about. It's not that I think I'm better than anybody else on the team, that I should get the ball because no one else can do it. No, it's nothing like that. I never say don't give it to other players. We have great players on the team, and we have to share the ball. But I'm saying if I'm getting the ball 9 times a game, that's not enough times for any running back anywhere in the NFL to make something happen.
The perception has been over the last few years around the league, Wayne, that it is forbidden, taboo to hit Wayne Gretzky. Do you feel off limits? Have you heard this? Have you felt this?
Well, I think that, you know, in my professional career, sometimes there's some not very smart comments that are made, and that's probably one of the most ridiculous comments that I've had to deal with in my career. I think if I was coaching a professional hockey team and I was in the other locker room, the first thing I would say to my guys is to punish Wayne Gretzky. And I'm sure that the coaches in this league are pretty intelligent and pretty smart, and I pretty much guarantee those are the first words that come out of their mouths in the team meeting. So I'm not off limits. I'm part of the game, and I expect to get hit, and that's just what the game is all about.
Let me ask you this. If you were an assistant to Lou Holtz, what would you like least about him?
I think I like least about Lou Holtz is he's not particularly patient. He has high expectations, and he doesn't worry about your feelings. He assumes we're all on the same team. We're part of family, and you don't have a lot of time, and you just have to express what you feel and don't worry about feeling. Yet at the same time, just like family, if you have a need or if you're down or you have a problem, he's going to be the first guy at your aid to help him.
Are you as demanding on your assistant coaches as you are on your players?
I don't know if I'm as demanding as maybe what I should be, and sometimes you let a reputation, et cetera, affect you. Yet I'll guarantee you this, that anybody who goes out and coaches will have the same expectations for assistant coaches and players I do. I think the greatest disservice we can do to anybody, Chris, is to lower the standard and say, I don't think you're very good. I'm more interested in being popular. I'm more interested in you liking me. The individual does that isn't a very, very confident individual. He's worried about pleasing people. My job is to get the very best out of people, make them as productive, because when people become productive, achieve things they didn't think they're capable of doing, their self-image will continue to grow, and that's all we try to do.
What about staying, though, in New York and winding up there, as was the notion before? Have you pretty much come to grips with that? That may not be a reality now?
Well, it may not be a reality, but certainly, you know, most of my family and friends that are here, you know, I grew up here, you know, they all look at me, especially after I suffered that injury, that, you know, what are you doing this to yourself for? Well, look, I'm from New York. I'm from Long Island. The Jets are a Long Island team. I love being back here. And certainly, it's not always going to be roses. I know that there are going to be tough times, and this is obviously the toughest of times, but I'm not backing down from that, and I'm not afraid of that. I know the player that plays this position for the New York Jets, whether it would have been Kenny O'Brien, Browning Nagel, Richard Todd, or Joe Namath, is going to have a lot of scrutiny thrown their way, and you have to be a special person to handle that, and I'm up to that task, no question.
So 0-4, you're good sports about it, but how personally have you come to grips with that issue?
Well, at times, you know, when you see different things and see players that have Super Bowl rings on that you've played against, like one of the Barr brothers, a kicker, who came to my golf tournament, and he had his Super Bowl ring on when he played with the Giants. That sort of hurt a little bit because he was showing it around. He wasn't even wearing it. He's carrying it in his pocket. That even makes it worse.
Well, that's not a kicker of all people.
Yeah, exactly. But... yeah, it hurts. I mean, everybody wants to win. Not everybody can. But I'm not. When I'm done playing football, I'm not going to look back and say that it was a total disappointment that we didn't win one. Yeah, it was very disappointing, but I'm not going to say that it ruined my career or something that I look back on and really feel very frustrated about it. I still have a couple more years left. Hopefully, we can get back. It's very difficult to do that, especially with free agency now, but I feel we still can.